All right. Now we should be able to read the serial number. I'd collect those bits of metal, too. They weren't part of the regulator. That's the record of Mary Marth's morphine usage. Take a look at the line of continuous usage during the last entry. I'd be surprised if that's not our cause of death right there. That's almost 100% bronze. It's a match. That bronze trace we found in the broken regulator pieces came from that bronze bust of Frank Marst. The evidence suggests someone took the bust from the front room and used it to break open the regulator. Then they removed the morphine control inside. Then the murderer pushed the button on the regulator to give Mary an overdose of morphine. If Mary was awake, she would have been forced to lie there and see it all happen. Helpless. Same tread, same size. So whoever passed by the bronze bust of Frank Marst also approached Mary Marst in her bed. So, the print on the bottle matches Jane Barrett. It says here she was arrested 6 months ago as part of a Death with Dignity demonstration in Carson City.
Based on what evidence?
Prints on the bottle of morphine belong to Ms. Barrett? Well, until Doc Robbins gives us the results of the autopsy, we can't even think about a warrant. But maybe Ms. Barrett will come in here voluntarily to answer some more questions. No harm in asking her, right?
Thank you for coming in voluntarily, Ms. Barrett.
Of course, officers. I'm happy to help with your investigation. To be honest with you, I'm uncomfortable with her appearance. She's trashy. She wears that nurse's uniform more like a stripper than a caregiver. However, John seems to think she does a good job, and Mary approved of her. No, of course not. Mary had already passed by the time I got here. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you meant today. I did change her morphine when it ran out during my visit last week. Euthanasia? Well, it's one of those... In theory, it sounds like something which could be a good thing, but in practice, what scares me is the opportunity for abuse. Kids offing their grandparents in order to inherit the money to buy a new cell phone? No, I'm opposed to it.
Miss Barrett, Are you aware that your fingerprints are on record because you were arrested 6 months ago at a death with dignity demonstration in Carson City?
I wish I could chalk that up to youthful indiscretion, but obviously I was old enough to know better. Suffice it to say, my politics 6 months ago had more to do with my personal relationships than my personal beliefs. I don't mean to suggest that there's anything wrong with the death with dignity people. It's just that I wasn't really with them, if you know what I mean. And honestly, having lived with Mary like this for all this time, I can't say I could make a decision like that. Especially because, even though she can't speak, I know Mary wants to live. I know that very much in my heart.
Ms. Barrett, could you tell us your whereabouts for the last 24 hours?
I live in Los Angeles. I come up here to visit with Mary once a week. I flew up here this morning. By that look on your face, I'd imagine you'd also like to know if anyone can verify what I'm saying, but I don't think anyone I know saw me. Oh, wait! Hold on. Actually, I have this excellent home security setup. Superior security systems. You see the way it works? You're either in the away setting with the motion detectors on, or the home setting with them off. They gave me an application for my cell phone that tracks when I'm home and when I'm away. I can send what it recorded for the last 24 hours to you, and you'll be able to see I was home, right up until I left for my flight this morning.
Okay. Send us those records, Ms. Barrett. But we'll still have to authenticate them with your security company. So I just got the records for Jane Barrett's security system from Superior Security. Looks like they check out. According to the records, Ms. Barrett was at home last night at 11. You know, the Mars family is still a pretty powerful player in this state. And it's pretty much an open secret that John Barrett was set to inherit everything when Mary Mars died. Jane Barrett wasn't even going to get a little something for the effort.
Well, being left out of the will is a possible motive, but what do we think about Jane helping Mary end her own life? Trying to give her death with dignity?
You know what death with dignity is? It means you don't drool. I think when you have a family with a lot of money to fight over, I don't trust any of them. But if Doc Robbins tells us the time of death clears Jane Barrett, then I'll move on to the next best suspect, family member or not. Vault Insurance Company was only too happy to provide us with their claim file on Mary Marst's accident.
Hey, Robbins here. Sorry if I slowed you down any, but I was finally able to determine your victim's time of death. You're looking at somewhere around 11 p.m. last night. Why don't you meet me in the morgue when you're ready? We can go over the rest of the autopsy results. Thanks for waiting. Ms. Marst's previous injuries, which resulted in extensive hypertrophic scarring, made my job a lot more challenging than I'd expected. I'm sorry if I've slowed you down any. Just because something walks like a duck and quacks like a duck doesn't mean we shouldn't assume it's a duck. The massive amounts of morphine found in the victim's system would lead one to expect death by overdose-related causes, and I did determine Ms. Marst's cause of death to be asphyxia due to morphine intoxication. Because the extensive scar tissue in Ms. Marst's lungs was hypertrophic, it took a little while for me to distinguish the morphine as the root cause of the asphyxia, as opposed to a more general catastrophic failure of the respiratory system due to her persistent condition.
Is it just me, Doc, or did this autopsy take a little longer than usual?
Well, Nick, it's just been a while since I examined a body with such severely burned tissues that hadn't been a contributing factor to COD. I estimate time of death to be somewhere around 11 p.m. last night. The problem I had with this one is, if you take a good look at the muscular atrophy, it presents like advanced rigor. These pressure ulcers and skin abrasions also led to some initial confusion over the degree of liver mortis. And finally, once I got Ms. Marst's medical records and saw she'd stopped eating solid food about 3 months ago, I knew I couldn't use any partially digested food to help set her time of death.
Man, you weren't kidding when you said this one was challenging.
Yeah, but that's what keeps the spark alive in this job. It's a good question, and I have no answer for you. Now, in a situation like this, where such a high dose of morphine is involved, I look for signs of cadaveric spasm. Because when voluntary muscles are deprived of oxygen due to, say, strenuous activity, these muscles tend to seize up perimortem, a and indications of cadaveric spasming, let's say in the hands or arms, would tend to suggest the victim was in the midst of a struggle around the time of death, and I looked for such indications. When I got the full tox report back, it seemed to me that the level of morphine in her system was so toxic, it probably caused her to slip very quickly into an unconscious state just prior to the total collapse of lungs. So, absent any indication of cadaveric spasm, I concluded your victim's voluntary muscles were not engaged in any such strenuous activity perimortem. The more important point here is that whether this was a deliberate act of murder or an assisted suicide, Mary Marst's death was the result of a homicide. No, it would have been impossible. Her medical records indicate Ms. Marst sustained multiple near-fatal injuries in a car crash. Apparently, she actually inhaled burning fuel, which obviously severely and permanently damaged her vocal cords. Sure, I collected them for you, as usual. Anything I can do, feel free to take a closer look at the body yourself. Oh, almost forgot. There's a shard of some kind embedded in the back of her left hand. I left it for you to collect. Scar tissue here is extensive, as well as hypertrophic. That's the shard I told you about.
Okay, so this pretty much backs up what Jane Barrett told us. She was home in Los Angeles last night. Pretty solid alibi. You may have something there. Jane comes to visit every Sunday, and every Sunday Mary's morphine usage becomes erratic. The records from Jane's security system indicate there was one Sunday when she stayed home. Now, don't you think it's odd she didn't happen to mention that one Sunday to us? It's also not reflected in Mary's pattern of morphine usage. It doesn't contradict Jane's alibi, but it's definitely worth keeping in mind. Looks like an acetone and some hydrogen cyanide combined into fibers of an ethylmethacrylate monomer and bonded with a similar but complex polymer of transparent thermoplastic. It's a tiny piece of a cosmetic fingernail. I wonder, when was the last time Nurse Lou had her nails done?
What evidence do you have? What if we do this? I'll talk to the nurse. See if she might be willing to come down here voluntarily to answer some questions. Maybe we'll get lucky.